بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم صلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. So continuing with our lessons in the Gospels, Muslim interpretation of the New Testament, we're looking at the Gospel of John. And initially, what we want to do before we continue looking at the content and themes of the Gospels, I want to take you through sort of a chart of Christology, interpretations of who was Isa alayhi salam in the first 4 centuries of the Common Era. So we have Isa alayhi salam, we have the historical Jesus. So historians will say this, historians like Albert Schweitzer, Bart Ehrman, Dale Martin, they'll say that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was a prophet, he believed himself to be a prophet and some sort of king. But they don't say that he claimed to be the Messiah or God or Son of God. So historically he viewed himself as being some sort of eschatological prophet, some prophet of the end of time, possibly, and a king in some sort of way. And then we have 3 different ways in which early Christians viewed Isa alayhi salam. So these are early Christian views, confessional views about Isa alayhi salam. This is what Christians believed. One view was that Isa alayhi salam was simply a human being. He was only human, okay? And as we said before, there's different groups that confessed this type of belief. Probably the most famous are called the Evionim or the Ebionites. So this is a very interesting group. I highly encourage people to do further research on the Christology of the Ebionites. Ebionites means the spiritual paupers, right? This was a group of Jews who continued to follow the Sharia, the mitzvot of Musa alayhi salam. They prayed in the temple. They believed in the oneness of God, the oneness of Adonai Eloheinu, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only difference between them and other Jews was that they believed that Isa alayhi salam was HaMashiach, he was the Messiah that they had been promised. Another group of Christians that we mentioned also, that we're going to elaborate, that also believed that Jesus was only human. They're called the Nozrim. So we know of their name, because when the Romans attacked the Temple of Solomon in the year 70 of the Common Era under General Titus, there was a rabbi in the city whose name was Yochanan ben Zakkai. Ben Zakkai, he went to the temple before they actually destroyed it, and he took the scroll of the Torah, and he snuck out of the city of Jerusalem, and he went to a coastal city right on the coast of the Mediterranean called Yavne. In English, it's called Jamnia. In Hebrew, it's called Yavne. And he began the rabbinical academy at Yavne. So this is actually where the modern-day Judaism was born. Rabbinical Judaism is from that academy at Yavne. And the oral law, it's called the Mishnah, that's where it was initially written down, at that academy. And a few things were instituted by the Jews during this time. The writing of the oral law, obviously. They set the Old Testament canon. 39 books are going to be the authoritative canon of the Old Testament, going from the book of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, all the way into the book of Malachi, 39 books. And also they had something called the Birkat HaMinim. The Birkat HaMinim in Hebrew means the cursing of the apostates, or the cursing of the, not apostates, the heretics, right? The minim means heretics, or the malediction upon the heretics. And included amongst the heretics are a group called the Nozrim. So it's really interesting, as part of the synagogue liturgy, as articulated by the academy at Yavne in the second century, part of the synagogue liturgy became cursing of Nozrim, cursing of the Christians. So the Jews, the rabbinical Jews, the Pharisees, they did not like these Christians, right? They called them Nozrim. Of course, the word Nozrim comes from the word Nazareth, which is Nazareth, which is the city that Isa alayhi salam, according to the New Testament, was raised. So this was a sect of Jews that were identified with Nazareth. And this is probably the cognate of the word Nasara in the Quran. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to the Christians, he calls them Nasara. So what is their Christology? Of the Evyonim and the Nozrim is that Isa alayhi salam was only a human being. So another way of saying this is called Semitic adoptionism. adoptionist Christology. What does that mean, adoptionist Christology? That means Isa alayhi salam was quote-unquote adopted to be God's son at his baptism. What does it mean to be adopted? So they mean this language to be figurative. This is majaz. Not that Jesus is the literal son of God. No, they didn't believe that because, again, these are Christians, if you want to call them Christians, that believe in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just as their Jewish brethren believed in the oneness. So when they use the term, you know, adopted to be the son of God, they simply mean that Jesus was given the mission of the Messiah, that at the baptism of Christ by John the Baptist, this is his bi'tha of sorts. This is when he was commissioned to be the Messiah. So that's what it means to be an adoptionist Christian, Semitic adoptionism. This Christology is also known as dynamic monarchism. Dynamic monarchism. What that means is that the Father, meaning God, he is the monarch, he is the first principle, and everything else is subordinate to the Father, including Jesus alayhi salam. So it's very, very interesting. This type of Christology was the Christology of the Bishop of Antioch in the 3rd century, whose name was Paul of Samosata. So you can look him up as well. I highly encourage people, when you hear some of these terms that I'm putting out there, obviously we don't have a live audience right now, but in future classes we're going to have a live audience, and also email me your questions. Write these names down, write these terms down, and we can elaborate on them. But very important name that you should make note of is the Bishop of Antioch, who died in 275 of the Common Era. His name was Paul of Samosata. And Paul of Samosata was a Unitarian, okay, a Unitarian Christian. He was actually a Socinian. So a Socinian Unitarian believes that there's no aspect of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, that predated his physical body, right? That he was purely a human being. He was a mere man, as he said. And this type of Christology is also referred to as psilanthropism, which means mere manism. That Isa alayhi salam was a mere man. He has nothing special metaphysically. He's just like everybody else. His specialness, right, his khas or khususiyat comes later on in his life because he was so righteous that God chose him and adopted him, as it were, again, majaz, this is figurative, to be his Messiah, right? But the first principles of Jesus are like everybody else, that God is the only monarch. This is called Semitic adoptionism. It's also known as dynamic monarchism or psilanthropism, mere manism, right? So Paul of Samosata, his student was named Lucian of Antioch, and he also believed in this type of Christology. And of course, and he died in 312 of the Common Era. And Lucian's student was named Arius, and this is the famous Arius of Alexandria, who was a presbyter at the church in Alexandria, Egypt, who caused so much trouble, as it were, for the Proto-Orthodox, that Constantine finally called the first ecumenical council, the first world council, the Council of Nicaea, to decide once and for all who is right. Is it Arius and those who are saying that Jesus Christ is a human being and that he's not God and that he's dissimilar to God? Or is it Athanasius and the proto-Orthodox Trinitarians that are saying basically that Isa alayhi salam shares an essence with God? So what happened at Nicaea was the vote was taken and Jesus was declared to be hamausias, which means of the same essence as God. Right? This was done by vote. 318 bishops were invited to Nicaea, modern-day Turkey. So what the other position said, what the Nutsrim, or the adoptionists, were saying, what dynamic monarchism is teaching, is that Isa alayhi salam is heterousias, meaning that he is completely different in his nature, in his essence, than God. And this is also Islamic Christology. In Islamic Christology, no one and nothing shares an essence or the attributes or the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That laysa kamithlihi shay'un, that there's nothing like the likes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing shares his essence, nothing has his attributes. Anyone who says that any human being has an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, somebody who claims that they're omnipotent, they know everything, right? Because that is a qualitative attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the sifatul ma'ani. This is what qualifies Allah. So anyone who makes that claim is claiming to be God, and that's rejected because no human being can ever be God, right? So the Quranic Christology, if you will, and Christology is a good term that you should become familiar with. Christology means the study of the nature and function of Isa alayhi salam, right? And it's not just, you know, what Christians believe, what everyone believes, Jewish Christology, Muslim Christology, atheist Christology. What do the atheists believe about Isa alayhi salam, right? Everyone has a Christology. So in the Quran, it's very clear that Isa alayhi salam's Christology is similar to this Ebionite or Nutzrim Christology. And there's evidence actually also that the Ebionim believed in the virgin birth of Isa alayhi salam. And of course, the Quran confirms that because Isa alayhi salam is a prophet and there are certain mu'jizat, there are certain miracles that are ascribed to him alayhi salatu wasalam. So in the Quran, he's the messenger of God. This is very, very clear. Isa alayhi salam is Rasulullah, and Muslims believe that, and we have to believe that. Isa alayhi salam in the Quran is a Nabi. He's also a prophet. Of course, the station of a Rasul is over a prophet. According to the Ash'ari Aqidah, the difference is that a prophet confirms the prophetic dispensation of the Rasul that came before him, or he receives the prophetic dispensation but is not ordered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to tell it to the people, right? There's no tabligh, there's no order of a dispensation or conveyance of the message, whereas a Rasul receives that dispensation and he is ordered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Muslims believe, according to the hadith, there's about 124,000 prophets. We don't know the exact number, but it's in that ballpark, 124,000 prophets. From these 124,000 prophets, 313, according to the hadith, these are the rusul, these are the messengers, right? So this is the next tier above al-anbiya. And then from the 313, there are five that are called ulul azmi min al-rusul, the people of firm determination, the people of firm resolve. These are the five most exalted prophets, the five most exalted messengers of God. And of course, these messengers, in chronological order, are Sayyidina Nuh and Sayyidina Ibrahim, Sayyidina Musa, Sayyidina Isa ibn Maryam, and Sayyidina Muhammad, alayhimu salatu wasalam. May peace and blessings be upon all of the prophets. These are the five great ones, right? So, and we also believe that Isa alayhi salam is a slave of God. It's very, very interesting. It's very, very interesting. When we read the Mawlid, or the birth narrative of Isa alayhi salam, which is given twice in the Quran, once in Surah Ali Imran and once in Surah Maryam, that the first words of Isa alayhi salam, as recorded in the Quran, his very first words to his people was, Inni Abdullah, Atani al-Kitaba wa ja'alani nabiyya. وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ وَأَوْسَانِي بِالسَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ مَا دُمْتُ حَيَّا. That his first words were defending his mother's honor and chastity. This is the first miracle of Isa alayhi salam, as recorded in the Quran. Of course, there's another narration that when Maryam alayhi salam gave birth, according to the Quran, that she heard a voice, right, saying, don't fear, and there's a spring of water underneath you, and wash yourself and drink of it and be refreshed. There's an opinion that that was also the voice of Isa alayhi salam, and some of the ulama, some of the mufassirin, they say that was Jibril alayhi salam. But nonetheless, one of the first miracles, if not the first miracle of Isa alayhi salam, as recorded in the Quran, is what? Defending his mother's honor and chastity. Because when she brought the baby in the sight of her family, they start insinuating things about her, right? Because she's unmarried and she's holding a baby, so they automatically suspect her of committing, adultery, hasha lillah. But that's what they thought that she had done. And the Jews to this day in the Talmud, they say things like that about Maryam alayhi salam. And the Quran tells us, وَبِكُفْرِهِ مَقَوْلِهِمْ أَرَ مَرْيَمَ بُهْتَانًا عَظِيمًا. So Isa alayhi salam, what can she say? فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ. The Quran says she pointed to Isa alayhi salam. And they said, كَيْفَ نُكَلِّمُ مَنْ كَانَ فِي الْمَهْدِ سَبِيَّ. How can we speak to one who is an infant, a child in the cradle? And then he said, indeed, inni, I am the slave or the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are his initial words, alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, his first miracle as recorded in the Quran. It's interesting, the first miracle of Isa alayhi salam recorded in the New Testament actually comes in the Gospel of John, although John again was the last gospel to be written. John is presenting something that happened in the life of Jesus that predates the miracles ascribed to him in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. So in John chapter 2, this is his first miracle, that Isa alayhi salam, according to the Gospel of John, is at a wedding in Cana, and people are having a good time at this wedding, and they're out of wine, so they come to him and they say, can you give us some wine? And then eventually he transforms water into wine so people can, drink wine and have a great time. This is his first miracle in the Gospel of John. Look at the difference here between the miracle in the Qur'an, where he's defending his mother's honor and chastity as an infant, bi-ithnillah, by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the first miracle in the Bible attributed to him is turning water into wine. Right? So this is the difference here. Also, he is the true Messiah in the Qur'an. The Qur'an calls him al-Masih. He is the Messiah. And a lot of Christians, they don't know this. And this is quite revelatory for them, that Muslims actually believe, because if you listen to people like Martin Luther, not Martin Luther King, Martin Luther, the German theologian and Augustinian monk who was one of the pioneers of the Protestant Reformation, he lived in the 16th century. Martin Luther writes a lot about Muslims, and he calls Muslims Antichrist, right? That's what he calls us. These are Antichrist. And Martin Luther obviously was very, very influential. There's maybe 900 million Protestants on earth right now, and the largest sect of Protestantism is Lutheranism. So they take Luther very, very seriously, and this is what Luther said about the Muslims, that they're Antichrist. And a lot of these people have no idea that Muslims actually believe that Isa alayhi salam is al-Masih. But what does it mean for him to be al-Masih? And they forget also sometimes that the whole concept of the Messiah is a Jewish concept. What did the Jews believe about the Messiah? Is that the Messiah will come and he will usher in an era of world peace, right? The Christians borrowed this concept and they said the way in which the Messiah will do this is that he'll die for your sins. He'll vicariously atone for your sins. And of course, this comes from Paul. This is Pauline Christianity. If you read the letters of Paul, like Ephesians, for example, Jesus is a sin offering, a sacrifice for the sins of humanity. The book of Romans, the book of 1 Corinthians goes into things like that. This is not the teaching of Isa alayhi salam. This is not what Luke is saying. Remember the Gospel of Luke very, very clearly. In the Gospel of Luke, Isa alayhi salam does not die for your sins. He makes you conscious of your sin and teaches you how to make repentance for your sin. In that sense, he is the Savior. So what does it mean for Isa alayhi salam to be the Messiah in Islamic Christology? Well, it means that he was specially chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring a special message to the Bani Israel. At the time of Isa alayhi salam, many of the Bani Israel, they had deviated from the teachings of Musa alayhi salam. In fact, the Sadducees, who were the high priests of the temple, they totally denied an afterlife. Right? They didn't believe in Al-Akhirah, what's known as Olam Hava in Hebrew, the world to come. They didn't even believe in that. So Isa alayhi salam is giving them spiritual teaching and also giving them bushra of the final messenger of God, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. And this is where the paraclete will come into play of the Gospel of John that we've talked about. We're going to talk about that a little bit later. But just to conclude here with this idea of Jesus being only a human being, the Quranic Christology again says that Isa alayhi salam is heterousios, that he's wholly dissimilar in his essence from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now we have these concepts of mystical union, right? So many of the mystically inclined Sufi writers will say things are things like, mystical union with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fana fillah, that one's ego is annihilated in the love and contemplation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And yes, this is the state of all of the prophets, and this is the state of the awliya and many of the mu'mineen, in that they've fallen in love with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they've emptied themselves of every type of egotistical vice, and they've become lord-like or godly, albeit in a non-absolute and contingent matter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, كُونُوا رَبَّانِيِّينَ. So this verse is Ali Imran, verse number 79. It's very, very interesting. According to Imam al-Suyuti, the sababu nuzul of this ayah, the occasion of its revelation came when a group of Christians came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they said, don't you know that Isa alayhi salam commanded us to worship him? So this verse was related that it's not befitting for any bashar, for any human being, to whom Allah gave the book in wisdom and the office of prophecy, to say, كُونُ عِبَادَ لِي مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ, for him to say, worship me in derogation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَكِنْ كُونُ رَبَّانِيِّينَ, rather he would say, be lordly, have these divine attributes. In other words, Allah is merciful, His mercy, He's Ar-Rahman, which is absolute, right, and infinite. But we can also be people of mercy. We can model our behavior and our actions after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Knowing that we're Allah's creation. This is called mystical union, right? So this is not ittihad. This is not our essence mingling with Allah's essence. No, that's not what the mystics are saying. That's not what Imam al-Junayd is saying. That's not what Abu Hamid al-Ghazali is saying. They're not saying that at all. That's not what Ibn Arabi is saying. No, they're saying that one becomes annihilated to the self, and one's only thought, one's only object of love is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when that happens, according to the hadith Qudsi, Allah says, then I am the eye by which he sees, and the hand by which he grasps, and the foot by which he walks, and if he were to ask anything from me, I shall surely give it to him. Meaning that we become guided in our actions, we become sanctified. So this we would say about Isa alayhi salam, that Isa alayhi salam, he was someone who was annihilated in the love and contemplation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But essentially, he is completely dissimilar. Nothing is similar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ. Nothing shares in his essence, his that, his sifat, or his af'al. Nothing shares in his essence, nothing shares in his attributes, and nothing shares in his actions. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, we have another Christology. So that's the group of Christians who said that Jesus was only human. We have another group of Christians in the first four centuries who said that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was only divine. He's only divine. He wasn't human at all. In other words, he's not even flesh. That's just how he appears to be, right? So, because he's only God, and God is not flesh and blood. So when you saw Isa alayhi salam, that was a vision that God gave you in order to make sense of this phenomenon known as God, that God gave you something to understand, but in reality it was an illusion, it was a phantasm. He wasn't a real human being, he just seemed to be that way. So these are groups of Christians known as Gnostic Christians. And of course Christian Gnosticism is extremely vast, and you have many, many different groups. But generally the Gnostics believed that Isa alayhi salam was only a divine being, and he wasn't really human, he just appeared to be human. And if he walked on the sand, he wouldn't even leave footprints, because he's not actually there. It's a phantasm. There's no flesh, there's no blood, there's no mass, right? There's no volume to him, nothing like that, right? So you have different groups of Gnostics. You have some Gnostics saying that Jesus is the only God. You have other Gnostics saying that Jesus is one of many gods. You have other Gnostics who say, like the Marcions, right? M-A-R-C-I-O-N. That's the founder, Marcion. We talked about him in the past as well. He was a bitheist. He said the God of the Old Testament is a different God than the God of the New Testament. Right? There's two gods, he said. And this was a very, very influential movement, especially in Rome. And modern-day contemporary atheists like Christopher Hitchens, who passed away recently, he actually says Marcion was onto something, because if you look at the descriptions of God in the Old Testament, you know, going around and ordering armies to completely obliterate city-states and nations, 31 city-states were completely destroyed, men, women, and children, by the armies of God under Moses and Joshua, according to the Old Testament. They'll say, well, Marcion, he understood that that can't be the God of the New Testament. So he was a bitheist. He believed in two gods. So this whole idea, right, that Jesus is only divine and not flesh, this is called docetism. Docetism, which comes from the Greek verb dokeo, which means to seem, to appear. So Jesus only appeared to be human. He only appeared to eat and drink and walk and talk. He only appeared to die. Right? So this was a very, very prevalent type of Christology. And then you have a third type of Christology, which is that Jesus is human and divine. He's both human and divine, right? Now the question becomes, well, when did he become divine? So you have a group of Christians who say he became divine when he was born. You have other Christians say he became divine at his baptism. You have other Christians who say he became divine at his resurrection, right? So here we have a difference of opinion. The early church father named Origen of Alexandria, the most prolific of any Christian writer in the history of Christianity, was this man Origen, O-R-I-G-E-N, of Alexandria. He lived around 250 of the Common Era. He wrote over 1,000 books, right? 1,000 books. He believed that Jesus was a divine being. However, he said that Jesus was created by the Father and was subordinate to the Father. So what does it then mean for him to be divine? Does he mean that he's also God or a lesser God? It's unclear, but it seems as if he's saying he's divine in the sense that he's been, again, sanctified by God. He's not deity, he's a human being who's holy. That's what it seems to be that they're teaching. This is called Origenism or subordinationism. So sometimes you'll hear this term, subordinationist Christology. What does that mean? That means the Son of God is subordinate to the Father. They're not equal. The Son serves the Father, and there's a lot of biblical backing for this. In the New Testament, we hear Isa alayhi salam reported to have said, "The Father is greater than I." This is from John. "The Father is greater than all." Again from John. "I can of my own self do nothing." This is also from John. In all four Gospels, we have Jesus going and praying and worshiping God, falling down on his face, it says. Proskuneo in Greek, which means to prostrate oneself before God. So Jesus, it seems like in the New Testament, is subordinate to and worshiping the Father in heaven. So Origen here, he has a point. However, Origen was eventually anathematized, which means he was eventually declared a heretic. To anathematize someone means to pronounce takfir upon them. This person is a heretic, right? And this was eventually done in the year 553 of the Common Era at a church council called the Council of Constantinople II. Constantinople II in the year 553, Origen was declared a heretic. He was the most, again, the most prolific of the early church fathers, the most prolific Christian author of all time. So when we say that there were groups of Christians who believed Jesus was human and divine, that's also very ambiguous. What does that mean for him to be divine? Does it mean that he was the same as the Father, or was he a demigod of some sort, or was he half God? When was he made God? There's a lot of difference of opinion. There was another group who said Jesus was human and divine, and he was always divine. He was always divine, right? And now the question becomes, what happened when he became human then? One group said that he became an additional person with an additional nature. So in other words, Jesus had two personalities. One person was Jesus of Nazareth, the other one was the Christ. So literally, he has multiple personalities. He also has two natures. This group of Christians are called separationist Christology, separationist. They actually believed that when Jesus was crucified, according to their belief, the person of Christ and his divine nature left Jesus. This is why he said, "Elahi, Elahi, lama sabachthani," my God, why hast thou forsaken me? This is the meaning of this verse according to separationist Christians, who believed again that Jesus was two persons and he had two natures. Obviously, this is total kufr. This is blasphemy for Orthodox Christians who believe that Jesus needs to die as God in order to redeem humanity, right? So even though they believed that Jesus was human and divine and that he's always been divine, right, they were still declared heretics because they said that when he became incarnated, he was actually two persons now, and that divine nature completely left him, leaving just a human being on the cross. And of course, one human being that's totally human being cannot redeem the sins of all of humanity. So this was seen as total heresy. You had another group who said that Jesus, when he became human, became another mode of the Father. This is called modal monarchism. Modal monarchism. What does that mean? It means that Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, they're all referring to the same person. So Orthodox Christianity, Trinitarian Christianity, says that God has one essence, one ousia in Greek, and three hypostases, three persons. One essence and three persons. What the modal monarchists are saying is that it's only one person. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are the same person, that there's no hypostatic distinction between the three persons. It's actually one person. What that means is God was the Father, and then he literally became the Son and died on the cross. So this belief is also called patripassianism, which means the Father suffers, that God literally died completely according to this Christology. And then when he was dead, he became the Holy Spirit, resurrected the Son, became the Son again, and then went back and became the Father. So God basically puts on three different masks. It's one God, one person, one essence. So obviously this was also seen as heresy by Trinitarian Christians, because Trinitarians believe that God was three persons, not one person. So even though this was actually a Unitarian Christology, it's seen as total heresy, because Trinitarians again believe in three persons, not one. And then you have finally the belief that, yes, Jesus was human and divine, and he was always divine, and when he became human, he became human with an additional nature. So he's one person with two natures, and this is the Orthodox Christian position. This is the Christian position of the world today, whether you're Catholic or you're Eastern Orthodox or you're Protestant. This is also known as Johannine Christology, and this is taken directly from the Gospel of John. It's also known as Logos Christology, a reference to the prologue of the Gospel of John. So you can see how influential the Gospel of John was in determining normative Christian orthodoxy with respect to Isa alayhi salam. So what I've just named for you is at least what I've just described for you with this Christology chart I have in front of me. And inshallah ta'ala, we can put this online so you can look at it when the classes actually begin, is that I've described for you nine different Christologies that were very prevalent during the first three and a half centuries of the Christian era. And amongst these nine, you have several subdivisions, dozens and numerous subdivisions of these nine Christologies as well. So one of these Christologies became what we know today as Orthodox Christianity, that Jesus is human and divine, and that he's always been divine. And when he became human, he became one person with two natures, meaning divine nature and a human nature. So that when he died on the cross, he died with that divine nature within him, so to speak, although the divine nature survived the cross. And this again is very much paradoxical. Now, returning to the Gospel of John. So, the Gospel of John, as we said, was written by the Johannine community. That's how they are referred to in academic research. The Johannine community. And if you read the first epistle of John, so remember we said this in our last class. We said traditionally, Christians believed that five books were written by the author of the Gospel of John. The Gospel of John, the first epistle of John, second epistle of John, third epistle of John, and the book of Revelation. Today, scholars will say this: the book of Revelation was not written by the Johannine community. It was written by a different community. And the author of the three epistles, although that author is reflecting the same type of Christology as the Gospel of John, it is not the same author as the Gospel of John. Although he's reflecting the same, again, type of Christology, this very exclusivist type of Christology. So in the first epistle of John, right, if you look towards the back of the New Testament before the book of Revelation, you'll find something called the first epistle of John. In the first epistle of John, chapter 2, verses 18 to 25, the author, whom we'll call John, describes a type of anti-Christian Christology. He says there are certain groups of people that are antichrist, right? And these are people who don't believe that Jesus is the Christ. So here he's talking about Jews, that Jews here are the antichrist. If you keep reading 1 John chapter 4, verse 1, you have another group that he calls antichrist. And these are people who believed that Jesus was not in the flesh. What does that mean? That means Christian Gnostics, Christians who said that Jesus was only divine and did not have a human body, right? So the first epistle of John is condemning these two groups of people. It's condemning the Jews because they didn't believe Jesus was Christ. He calls them antichrist. And also those who said Jesus did not have a physical body, right? That he says, whoever does not believe Jesus Christ came in the flesh is accursed, right? So you have these two antichrist threats. Now, most scholars actually believe that the Gospel of John has at least two authors. And this is very important. So they believe one of them they call the evangelist, whoever actually wrote this book. He's called the evangelist. And then you have someone called the redactor, someone who took the Gospel of John as it was originally written and made some additions to it to kind of clean it up a little bit. Because remember this, we mentioned this the last class. Amongst many early Christians, the Gospel of John was initially seen as this alien sort of Gnostic gospel that was very, very different than the Synoptic Gospels. In fact, many Christians believe that a Gnostic named Corinthus was the actual author of the Gospel of John. So a later redactor goes into the Gospel of John and adds, according to this theory, chapter 21 of the Gospel. He adds what's known as the epilogue of the Gospel of John, right? Why does he add the epilogue? Because in the epilogue, Jesus comes back after his resurrection, he goes to Galilee, and he eats breakfast with his disciples. And you think, what does that have to do with anything? Who cares if he ate breakfast? Well, this was added in order to refute this idea that Jesus was only God. He was also a human being who's eating food. That's why that was added at the end of the gospel. Because the redactor wanted to show that Jesus was also a human being. So this last chapter of the Gospel of John was added to the end of it. Because the original Gospel of John, according to most scholars, ended at John chapter 20. And now we have this epilogue that was added later. Also, chapter 6 of the Gospel of John is believed by many scholars to be a later addition to the Gospel of John. Chapter 6 actually describes the Mass, the Holy Communion, where Jesus says, and according to this chapter, that you must eat my flesh and drink my blood if you want eternal life, things like that. The reason that was added is because the Last Supper in the Gospel of John does not have the institution of the Eucharist, of eating the bread and drinking the wine as being the transubstantiated flesh and blood of Christ. That whole Holy Communion is not mentioned during the Last Supper of the Gospel of John. So many scholars, including Rudolf Bultmann, who's eminent New Testament scholar, German scholar, he said chapter 6 was added later by someone called the ecclesiastical redactor. And we have also chapters 15 through 17 as being candidates for later additions to the Gospel of John. Even some scholars say the prologue itself, the hymn to the Logos, was added later. Bart Ehrman will suggest this in his book, for example. A great book that you should get is called Misquoting Jesus. It's written for a lay audience about textual criticism of the New Testament. And he'll go into the Gospel of John and he'll look at the prologue, the first 18 verses of John chapter 1, where Jesus is explicitly called God twice in the prologue, and Ehrman will argue that that prologue is a later addition to the Gospel of John. A later addition. This is quite significant, because nowhere else in the Gospel of John is Jesus directly called God, or does he make a claim directly to be God, right? So the prologue, he says, was added later. And why does he say this? It's because you find it in a certain different style Its vocabulary is different than the rest of the gospel. Its style is very different than the rest of the gospel, at least according to the textual analysis of Bart Ehrman. So that's very, very interesting. Now, what happened, according to scholars, was you have the Johannine community. You have this community that authored the Gospel of John. Scholars believe that a significant segment of that community became Gnostic in their Christology. In other words, they said Jesus did not have a physical body. So they took the gospel with them and started their own community. So in response to that, the other half of the community, they made these additions to the Gospel of John to present more of the humanity of Jesus, but at the same time also present him as being God. That's why the prologue was added as well. So that's pretty much standard amongst New Testament scholars. So this secessionist or separatist movement took the gospel with them and became full-blown Gnostics. Remember, it is a historical fact that the gospel was used by Gnostic circles. In fact, the first commentary on the Gospel of John, and this is a historical fact, the first commentary ever written on the Gospel of John was written by a man named Heraclion, H-E-R-A-C-L-E-O-N. Heraclion was a Valentinian Gnostic. He was a Gnostic. So it's very, very interesting that many scholars believe the Gospel of John was written by a Gnostic, Corinthus, and it is a historical fact that the first commentary ever written on the Gospel of John was written by a Gnostic named Heraclion. That tells us that originally the Gospel of John was a Gnostic gospel that would have been totally rejected by the vast, vast majority of Christians today, but it was eventually cleaned up by someone called the Redactor, and Jesus was presented as human and divine, and eventually it was accepted as a canonical text. What's also interesting about the Gospel of John is that there's no birth narrative of Isa alayhi salam. So remember, the Gospel of Mark doesn't have a birth narrative. It begins with Jesus' baptism, but Luke and Matthew, taken from the Q source document, apparently, we talked about the Q source document, they include a molid or a birth narrative of Isa alayhi salam. In the Gospel of John, there is no birth narrative. What we have is the prologue of John's Gospel. Because Jesus becoming flesh as man, that's the most important thing, right? That Christ has pre-eternality. So the author of the Gospel of John doesn't bother himself with the virgin birth. The most important thing is that Jesus, in the beginning, was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So who cares if it was a virgin birth? Jesus is God, according to the understanding of at least the prologue of the Gospel of John. There's also no baptism of Jesus. So Matthew, Mark, and Luke, all three of them say that John the Baptist baptized Jesus. John doesn't mention that at all. The reason why he doesn't mention it is because, again, it sort of shows or demonstrates that Jesus is inferior to the Baptist, that Jesus is sort of taking the Baptist mantle, if you will. The Baptist is passing the baton to him. The Baptist is giving him permission now to teach, and so on and so forth. So the Gospel of John didn't like that. Jesus is independent of and superior to the Baptist. So in the Gospel of John, the ministry of Jesus and the ministry of John the Baptist are actually concurrent, whereas in the synoptic tradition, Isa alayhi salam, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, his ministry comes after the Baptist was put in prison and beheaded by Herod Antipas. In fact, in the Gospel of John, we have this very bizarre statement. We have John the Baptist, when he sees Jesus for the first time, he says, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." This message is vastly different than what we have in the synoptic traditions, where John the Baptist is saying, "Repent and bear fruits of righteousness. You know, work hard and repent to God." And suddenly in the Gospel of John, we have this statement, "The Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." Of course, this is in sharp contrast to the synoptic tradition. So what the Gospel of John is trying to do, in other words, is trying to promote Jesus and give him this really high type of status, higher than John the Baptist, or even John the Baptist recognize that this is someone who's going to die for your sins, right? We don't find that interpretation in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. We also have no temptation of Isa alayhi salam. You know, in the Synoptic Gospels, Jesus goes to the wilderness and Satan will tempt him, right? We don't find that at all in the Gospel of John because, you know, it's not befitting of Christ to be tempted by Satan. Again, we also have no exorcisms performed by Jesus. Jesus is above such petty types of tricks. Jesus is too powerful to be devalued and ignored. So there's really no clear rejection of Jesus at Nazareth. So in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, very clearly, he's rejected by the people of Nazareth. But the Gospel of John, the author of the Gospel of John doesn't like that idea that Jesus is rejected by anyone. Because for him, Jesus is, again, very, very exalted, a very high Christology. The teaching style in the Gospel of John is very different as well. In the Gospel of John, we don't have any of the parables that figure so prominent in the Synoptic Gospels. No types of parables. Instead, you have these very long philosophical, theological speeches of Jesus about his own nature, these very long monologues, right? None of Jesus' reinterpretations of the law of Moses that are, again, very, very prevalent in Matthew, Mark, and Luke are found in the Gospel of John, right? We talked about the antitheses of the Sermon on the Mount. You have heard, in other words, when Jesus says something like, you have heard them say this, but verily I say this unto you. And he quotes the law and he gives his own interpretation of it. There's none of that found in the Gospel of John. The only thing that Jesus commands in the Gospel of John is to love one another. That's it. There's no prediction of Jerusalem's fall in the Gospel of John because it's not important. That was 30 years ago. It's not an important thing. There's no prophecy of the second coming of Jesus. There's no stress on future eschatology because John believes very important theme in the Gospel of John is what's known as realized eschatology. That the second coming of Christ has already happened in the form of the paraclete, right? We'll talk about the paraclete in subsequent sessions, inshallah ta'ala. So we're going to spend quite a significant amount of time, actually, on the Gospel of John. Again, there's no institution of communion or Eucharist in the Gospel of John at the Last Supper scene. So in the Last Supper, according to Matthew and Mark, Jesus, you know, he takes the bread and the wine. This is my body. This is my blood. This is the blood of the New Testament that's going to be shed for many. There's nothing like that in the Gospel of John. In the Gospel of John, the Last Supper is not even a Passover meal. It happens the night before Passover. So Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the Last Supper is on Thursday night. In the Gospel of John, it's on Wednesday night. And all Jesus does on Wednesday night at the Last Supper is wash the feet of his disciples. There's no institution of communion. So this is a clear contradiction in the New Testament. Both cannot be correct. There's no way to harmonize this. When did the Last Supper happen? Did it happen on Thursday night or Wednesday night? You cannot harmonize it. Somebody is right here and somebody is wrong, or both accounts are wrong, right? But they both cannot be right. Very clear contradiction. There's no agony in the Garden of Gethsemane. So in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you have Jesus going to the garden and he collapses on the ground. You know, Father, remove this cup away from me, not as I will, but as thou will. This type of trying to get out of death, trying to be saved by God. None of that is in the Gospel of John because, again, John, the author of the Gospel of John, doesn't like this idea that Jesus has any type of weakness. It's a very high Christology. In fact, in the Gospel of John, very interestingly, it says that a cohort of soldiers came to the mountain as well. And this implies that there were Roman legionnaires that came to arrest him. And they ask, where is Jesus? And he says, Anehu in Hebrew, which means I am him. And when he says that, everyone falls down in prostration when he says that. Very, very strange type of thing that's mentioned in the Gospel of John that I've never seen any movie depict because it would seem very, very strange for that to happen. But that's what the Gospel of John actually says. Now, next time, we're going to talk about a very important topic when it comes to the Gospel of John is not only the paraclete, but also the differences in the passion narrative of the Gospel of John. If you read Matthew, Mark, and Luke, especially Mark's Gospel, you may conclude that maybe it wasn't Jesus who actually died, or maybe that Jesus was put on a cross, but he didn't actually die, what happened, it's a little ambiguous. So the Gospel of John is trying to make it clear for you that Jesus was crucified and he was killed, he was buried and he was resurrected. And I'm going to show you how John actually does that, because again, John, one of the advantages that John has is retrospect. He can look at all these Gospels, he can look what the Christians are believing in, and he can tailor his Gospel exactly to what he wants to teach. So we'll talk about that next time, inshallah ta'ala. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.